George's all. And when he tried to knock us down and we stood up tall, this city will forever be me saving grace. So no matter where I am, I'll raise a glass to this place.
Growing up, I suppose the odds were always stacked against us. Scousers in the 90s, it was heavy going for everyone in the city, and what we all have in this city is just grit and determination, and we just don't stand down. We don't let people roll us over. Adversity, poverty and inequality has forged this resilience within us all. I think when the chips are down, every Scouser has just got that in them. I think you really do have to prepare. As I was younger, before I was at the upper echelon of the division or the sport, it would just be about expressing myself, going in the gym and having fun. And then, unfortunately, when it becomes a business and you're fighting to be number one in the world, that kind of changes. So it's about correct recovery, correct sleep, correct food. I know if I go out on a Saturday, I'm probably going to get injured on a Monday or Tuesday. I have to be so careful. You have to mentally prepare and physically prepare before you get on that mat. If you're not switched on, if you're not attuned to what is asked of you in that session, you just get hurt. I think the biggest attribute to being a successful athlete and how you get there is accountability and showing up every day. And the way in which I am successful is turning up on the mat and putting the effort in. Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. And that's the story of this city. That's the story of every most athletes. It's not like who runs more, who lifts more, who does this, that and the other. It's how you apply yourself in training and how you want to learn and to win and to be there. Like, if you're first on the mat and you're last off, think how much knowledge you're gaining over someone who turns up 5 minutes later, missed the warm-up. Over a year, that accrues so much. That's like a couple of thousand hours. It only takes 10,000 hours to be the elite of the elite at that discipline or that sport. I think winning the Cage Warriors world title just... I always used to say, like, I've got a world championship mindset, so the belt didn't really mean anything, but I suppose it affirmed to me that I am who I said that I am. It was the first time Paul Rimmer said he was proud of me. I'll never forget that. Was the first woman to headline in the Echo Arena, first English woman to win a major world title in MMA. I didn't even smell the roses. I think I went on the ale for like a week and then got signed to the UFC, so I didn't even get to like live in it. But I never brought the belt home. I put it straight in the gym. I didn't start till I was 23, do you know what I mean? So anyone who walks in, you're never too old to be who you want to be. Last July, co-main event, UFC London. Never doubted myself until I got in there. When I got beat, first thing I said was, fucking hell, I'm going to get destroyed online. Paul took my phone off me, gave it to Leah. Leah logged me out of Instagram. And all anyone said, don't go online, don't go online. And I was like, is it bad? And they was like, I've never seen it this bad for someone before. Do you know what I mean? And I was just like, and we flew to Ireland the next day, me and my family. And I just went out there and I just had so much shame and embarrassment, and it was just like, if people could only see what I actually do every day. I think sometimes me and Paddy wear the crown well, but heavy is the heart that wears the crown, do you know what I mean? It's just like so fucking hard. And I just sat there and I was like, how? We was in Ireland and it was every pub going to have a Guinness, spend a nice time with the family. It's like, what am I going to do, Mum? And she went, go to Thailand and just go out there and just start again. And I went out there, and the way people approached me out there, it's like true martial arts, you know what I mean? It wasn't the win or the loss that defined me. It's Molly McCann, it's not the meatball. And Bang Tao, and a big shout out to them and everyone out there, like the people out there just made me like, it was new people that I didn't know. Everyone wanted a round with me. And in them rounds, because I was training with smaller women, I was like, hang on a minute. And I just started to get myself back on track. And I came back and I said to Paul, I said, you can ring Graham now, like, I'm ready to go. And Graham was like, a little bit longer. And then I'd done a pro jiu-jitsu match on Polaris. There was more pressure on that than any UFC fight, because I put myself to the mercy of the trolls, really. Do you know what I mean? Look, all right, I've been finished here by jiu-jitsu. Let me come to a jiu-jitsu-only professional match against a judoka, someone who's great at arm bars and throws and has been on Pilates a few times. And I fucking arm barred here, didn't I? And then they was like, right, go on, you've got to fight. And yeah, when I won that jiu-jitsu match, I was like, I'm made for this weight, and I'm here now. I had got to the UFC and got to a pretty high standard and level without having to take supplements. The marginal gains is what makes the big difference over a long period of time, and applied nutrition really helped with that. And whatever product I want, they've probably got about 12 different flavours of it. Some of them are a little bit funky and I'm not into them, do you know what I mean? Like, me and Pad have got opposite in our taste, so what I like, he wouldn't, and what he likes, I wouldn't. Or the yin and the yang, I suppose. I feel like the hellbow changed my life forever. When I've spun and hit her and she's like dabbing mid-air and I'm like, that's something you dream of. That's something you play in the PS and you play in the games. Like, you think, oh, yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, these are shots that you could practice every day of your life and never land at. And I did. And we had drilled it. It weren't a fluke. There was videos in the changing room of us drilling it 15 minutes before. How my life skyrocketed after that was just a whole nother level. I do believe, like, if Paddy wasn't on that fight card and if he didn't win in the fashion he did and we had that moment together in the cage after, I don't know if it would have gone as wild as what it did, but I can only ever thank him enough for that. Yeah, that changed my life forever. Like, the sponsorships that I got off that, it got me this. All I ever wanted was to have a home and roots, and I got it through fighting, so that was always a bonus. And I got signed to the UFC off 8 fights, and that's quite unheard of. Like, I've been doing MMA for 5 years. That's like not a lot of time to learn a craft. I just gone bang, and it was so hard to learn the IQ and how different the fighting was at the higher level. And I learned in front of the world through all of these fights, and I thought I'd gone on that tear with Paddy and I'd won these fights and these big finishes, and then bang, lost the fight, and then bang, lost the fight, and got finished in exactly the same style in both of them. And I was just like, I'm done, mate. I'm not putting all this working and sacrifice to go with someone who just wants to lie on me on the floor. And the team sat me down and went, when you're fighting people who are as little as you, that doesn't happen. How much do you want to be a world champion? I said, with everything that I've got inside me. He said, well, cut the weight and make 115. And then the whole last fight camp, it was like, I didn't have 1 ounce of doubt that I weren't going to destroy that girl I was getting in there with. It was crazy because I was coming off, like, if I had lost that, like, that was me done. In 4 minutes and 59 seconds, elbowed, knees, kicked, judo through, wrestling takedown, jiu-jitsu on the floor, ground and pound on the floor, orthodox southpaw boxing, kickboxing, jiu-jitsu armbar to finish with a second left. I could have finished with elbows, looked at the time before, oh, fuck it, this is for all the trolls, bang, and just spun into the armbar. And to be finished by armbars twice and then to go on, I'll just do it. That feeling of, like, the winner's always shared with the team, and like that changing room, me, Paul, Paddy and Ellis and Adam, when we sit and that changes, and like Wayne Rooney comes in, Stormzy comes in, Dave Portnoy comes in, and we're just all sat there just laughing like, what the fuck is going on here? Like, the stories that we can tell from winning, like, I used to be scared about losing because you'd only get half the money, and now I don't, like, it's a privilege to fight, it's not a right. And I think every time you get to get in there. On them sessions you feel like shit. When you finish them, you are that one more session closer to getting in there. And that is like, I suppose the Vikings would say, like Valhalla, like for you to get in that octagon. You can't buy your way in there. It is aim, not given, do you know what I mean? And them sessions, that's the aim, the deposit in the bank. That's money in the bank to get there. The UFC asked me to do this and I wrote a letter to myself from 10-year-old Molly to fighting at MSG, and it kind of just said, like, don't be embarrassed when you haven't got what everyone else has got. When you're going into training or you're going into new environments, you might not look the same as everyone else. You might have to walk there, ride a bike, and they're all in cars. And like, how you arrive and how you look doesn't determine who you are and what you're about. Have faith in yourself that your ambition, talent, and resilience always trumps anyone else. The payoff is well worth all the hard work.
In the mornings when I'm getting ready, I'll have my brekkie, sit down and then ground myself before the day starts. My life's a bit of a madness, so I have to keep an old school diary. Not looking inside it though. But it, you can't teach hard. But I just check my stuff, go through that, put my tunes on, and then try and get off my head a little bit off that drink. Because in fight camp sometimes you just, it's a hard life, but these make you go. Paddy fought before me, like the first time ever. And I went out and I watched them, and then I watched them do the business. I thought, right, I've got to go and do it now. And then I went into the bar, and he's come in, he sat with me, and we're getting ready. I said to Paul, like, this is the last time I'm doing this. But win, lose or draw, like, I'm not doing this again. I just can't take the pressure. It's like, and then I won anyway, smashed it to bits. And then I was like, I'm only messing. And then we went the beer keller and parties on. When we think about the past, it can like trouble us. And I think when we think about the things we want in the future, that's what gives you anxiety and doubt. And I think if we're able to sit in this moment now and be like, am I applying myself the correct way? Yes. Am I eating the correct way? Yes. Am I training as hard as I can? Yes. Am I enjoying it? Yes. Am I hating it? Yes. These are all things that you have to sit in and just slow down and focus on now. And I think when you do that, you get a better, I don't know, you can get better sessions, you're thinking better, you're not panicked about the outcome, you're just focusing on now.